this conference. And my dear brother, Dr. Kiran Singh, and all the dignitaries present here. You know, now the Brussels attack is in the news. I would say that all the Muslims of the world and other peace-loving people must condemn this horrible act. In this circumstances, present program is very relevant. I think that life positive is not only a magazine, it is a mission, peace mission. I believe that doing a very revolutionary job. You know, peace cannot be established independently. Peace is a byproduct of some other things. And that is positive thinking. Where there is positive thinking, there is peace. First of all, we have to inculcate positive thinking among people. This will provide the basis of peace culture. And then it is possible to establish a peaceful society. This is my experience. So I welcome the management of positive thinking that they are doing a very good job. I say that revolutionary job. It is this kind of campaign that will lead to a peaceful society. Peaceful society cannot establish independently. It requires a basis. And this basis is positive thinking. So I would say that I'm a part of this campaign. I am part of this magazine from the outset. Then I would say that peace or harmony are very important, very, very important. Without peace, there is no development. Without peace, there is no progress. So, is it right to say that peace is sambhavana or greatest good? Here I would try to add that I am an optimist. I am an optimist person. I can say that Brussels attack will lead to something that is very good. It will create a rethinking among Muslims. It is bound to create a new thinking among Muslims. Muslims are used to say that all these things are Islamophobia, phenomena of Islamophobia. But now, under compulsion, they certainly will think that Islamophobia failed to work. the formula of Islamophobia failed to work. Why? Recently you have read a news item that, I would say, would be present Donald Trump has openly gave a remark, that very, very shocking remark, that American Muslims or those Muslims are settled in Western world in general are enemy within. It's very shocking remark. But you know that there is a law of nature that sometimes there are positive aspects of shocks. So I think that it is blessing in disguise. I have talked to some Americans after this remark. I said that I believe that American Muslims are bound to rethink after this remark. They are bound to think that formula of Islamophobia failed to work. Now we need some other formula. No Muslim will leave the America or West. They will stay in Western world. No American is going to leave the America or Western world. Then they are bound to think that we have to create some justification. Now we have no justification. If our countrymen take us as an enemy, then it means that we fail to create a justification. So they are bound to rethink, and they think that we have to correct the image of Islam, image of Muslim community. No other formula will work. If we say that Islamophobia, it will not work. Muslims are bound to think that we have to provide some substantial justification of our presence in Muslim world. And that is given in the Quran in these words, Wamma Mayan Ho Nas Fam Kosupilla. It means that if you are a given member of society, that society will accept you. If you are a taken member of society, society will not accept you. So Muslims are Western world, under compulsion, must rethink that we have to change our image. Now our image is we are problem community in the West. We have to change this image. We are not problem community. We are a giver community. We are asset for West. So this process will begin from the correction of image of Islam. Islam is a religion of peace. In fact, Islam is a religion of peace. Islam has nothing to do with violence. The very name of Islam means the religion of peace. Quran says that Wallahu Yadu Walada Islam. God calls to the home of peace. God invites to build a world of peace. So this is the true image of Islam. So Muslims are bound to rethink, to restudy the Quran and rediscover. Muslims are bound to rediscover the peaceful aspect of Islam, because there is no other option. No other option. Those Muslims are living in America or in West, they are not going to leave that country. They are settled, their children are settled over there. It is not possible for them to leave that country. It is also not possible to dream to continue blame the others. If they say that West is an enemy of Islam, it will not work. Note, according to the Quranic formula, they have to prove themselves that they are an asset to the Western world. They are not liability. Islam is religion of peace. Also, Muslims are a community of a peaceful community. You know, the great events in history were due to compulsion. All the great events of history were due to compulsion. For example, before Second World War or First World War, all the nations were believing in violence, in war. Might is right. But when by the end of Second World War, America dropped two nuclear bombs in American cities, the whole things were changed. Now people began to think under compulsion that war is not an option. War is not an option. Now only peace is the option. Under this situation, old League of Nations was revived in the name of United Nations. Now United Nations is a powerful institution. Before it was not. League of Nations was not very powerful institution. But after Second World War, now we are living in the age of United Nations. All the people are thinking in terms of peace. For example, let us take the example of Japan. Japan was a warring country before Second World War. But after America dropped two nuclear bombs on the American cities, the Hirohito, the king of Japan, Hirohito, addressed nations. He was a very learned person. Hirohito was a very learned person. He addressed nation on radio. He said, "We have to bear the unbearable. We have to bear the unbearable so that we may create a new future for Japan." And then they diverted all their energies towards scientific education, industry, and constructive development. Now you know, Japan, after 30 years of planning, Japan emerged as a economic superpower. Not through violence through peaceful struggle. So this history is bound to find response in Muslim nations also. Now it is compulsion. Now it is for Western Muslims, it is compulsion to accept peace, abandon war or violence culture. I am a great believer that very soon you will find that age of suicide bombing is over. There is no suicide bombing. The remark given by Donald Trump is like atomic bomb for Muslim community. The harsh remark of Donald Trump is like bomb. I have contacted some American Muslims for radio, and they confirmed that you are right. Here in America, there is rethinking among educated Muslims that we cannot live by the traditional mind, jihadi mind or violent mind. We have to change ourselves. We have to change our image. We have to change the image of Islam. So I think that American president remark was very harsh, apparently, but it will serve as the atomic bomb for Muslim community. Very soon you will find that Muslim community has changed their mind. They will disseminate the peaceful teaching of Islam. They will admit that now the age of jihad is over, age of violence is over, age of war is over. Now we have to revive that spirit of Islam, that Billah Yadu Walada Islam. God Almighty is peace, and He invites people to live in peace. It is not, it is by optimistic remark. Some people may disagree, but I am firm believer that very soon all thinking people will accept my reward, and Muslim community will emerge as a new peaceful community. What the peaceful sermon, where the peaceful sermon failed? The atomic atomic statement, like bomb, like bomb statement of American president will work. In the end, I will congratulate the management of Life Positive. They are doing very good job. They are paving the pace of peace. They are providing the basis of peaceful society. May God bless you. May God help you realize this noble cause. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you so much, Maulana Ji. It was wonderful to hear you, and it's beautiful to see how we can take, the approach that we can take responsibility for our actions and change ourselves, because no solution lies outside of ourselves. Sincerely hope and pray that the Muslim community will speedily adopt your point of view. Thank you so much. I now invite Dr. Karan Singh.
Respected Maulana Bahiduddin Sahab, members of the Life Positive Parivar, a lot of people here I know have been associated with this journal for the last 20 years. Kartikeyan is here, others are here, and friends. Let me at the outset say that today is a day of deep significance because it is Easter Sunday. Easter involves the resurrection of the spirit after the crucifixion of the flesh. For Christians, of course, it has a special theological significance. But even for non-Christians, it clearly symbolizes the fact that the true essence of a human being does not lie in the body, it lies in the spirit. So that even if the body is crucified or the body ends, bhasmantam shariram, it again, the spirit can be released. And that revival of the spirit, the rebirth of Jesus in the heart of each one of us, who is crucified on the cross of matter and needs to be reborn again, that is the essence of the spiritual quest. I think that's tremendously important. And today is a day when we rededicate ourselves to the significance of the spiritual resurrection, the adhyatmik punarjanma, whereby we are able to overcome the problems that we face. I would also like to warmly congratulate and join Maulana Sahab in warmly congratulating Life Positive for having kept the flag flying for 20 years. I remember I was involved many years ago in one of your anniversaries. I think it was the 5th. So you forgot about me for 15 years, and now I'm back here again 15 years later. But I've been reading your journal fairly regularly, except for the last few months I'm not receiving it. There's something wrong with your receipt and dispatch organization. Just look
at
it.
We will make sure you get it.
But Life Positive is very good. It has a lot of very interesting articles, and it has a lot of, material that is uplifting. I think Maulana Sahab was quite right when he said that if we start with a negative and pessimistic attitude, then we are not going to be able to achieve anything. Then we have, in a way, conceded defeat even before the battle has begun. Therefore, it's important to have a positive attitude, and Life Positive covers meditation, it covers yoga, it covers health, it covers sex. You did a big one on sex. I remember I was on the cover for some odd reason. I don't know why I was put on the cover that time. Nothing to do with me, but you remember that special issue and so on. So every time there's something exciting, something new, and something interesting. So congratulations to Life Positive. Friends, we are now at a very crucial phase in the history of humanity. Maulana Sahab's very optimistic view, I wish I could share. I'd love to share it, and I hope and pray that it comes true, and that all the terrible events that we are seeing now will ultimately lead to a rethinking among those elements that are committed to violence and hatred. But history tells us that that is unlikely to happen. For example, the greatest menace of the 20th century, there were several, but Hitler probably represented the epitome of the Asuric forces, of the forces of evil, the forces of violence, the forces of hatred. And it was only when he was defeated on the ground that there was a rethinking in Germany. Not while he was in power. As you rightly said, Maulana Sahab, it was only when the atomic bombs fell on Japan that ultimately they realized that now they have to take the path of peace. So my submission is that until ISIS is defeated on the ground, I don't think you will have the massive rethinking that you're hoping for. I hope you're right. But experience has told us again and again that there are situations in which sometimes the forces of evil have actually to be beaten on the ground. And once that happens, then there is a rethink. It happened in Germany, it happened in Japan. It will happen also in West Asia, I'm sure, provided, because we have now a so-called state which is committed to hatred and violence and crucifying people on television and cutting people's heads off. What sort of barbarism is this? We thought that we had left it behind 1,000 years ago. We haven't. So this is something which we all have to deal with. And I think the way to deal with it is really what we have been doing all these years, the interfaith movement. The reinterpretation and rearticulation of religion in positive terms, which is in Islam, I think, Maulana Wahiduddin Khan is the ultimate practitioner of that rearticulation. Some of us have tried to do it. I have tried to do it in the Vedanta. Because, you know, in every religion, there are two elements. There are some elements which are immediate to where the religions were born, and there are some elements which are eternal. Now, if you get involved in theological controversies, you are never going to get a common ground for religions. For example, if you talk about rebirth, half the world believes in reincarnation, the other half doesn't believe it. So you can go on arguing forever and ever, you never come to any conclusion. But if, for example, you take positive things, you take the importance of safeguarding the natural environment, you take the importance of the welfare of children, you take the importance of spreading health and education around the world, you take the importance of trying to bring about a better understanding between the various religions by all the interfaith meetings that we've had ever since 1893 in Chicago. There have been hundreds and hundreds of meetings. Maulana Sahib has attended many. I have attended many. Merchant here, he's been to the last two parliaments. But somehow or the other, I get the impression that we are preaching to the converted. The people who come to these interfaith gatherings are already committed to interfaith. The point is, as Maulana Sahib said, how do you get to the people who are committed to violence? Unse jab tak baat nahi hogi ya unko jab tak khatam nahi kiya jayega tab tak ye baat niklegi nahi aage. To hame dono karni, we have to do both things. On the one hand, we have to be very aware, very careful and very sensitive. India is a country where all the great religions of the world have flourished. Hinduism, Buddhism, Jainism and Sikhism were born in India. The great religions of the West came. Christianity came AD 57, almost in the lifetime of Jesus. Judaism came. We are the only nation in the world that has never persecuted the Jews. They lived happily. Many of them went to Israel when it was formed. But we still have Jewish communities in South India. Then you had Zarathustrians came after the great kingdoms of Xerxes and these great rulers were destroyed in Iran. They fled, and a tiny community like the Parsis, look at the contribution they have made to India in every field. And then of course Islam came. Now Islam, Maulana Sahib, as you keep saying, as I keep saying, came in two incarnations. One were the iconoclasts, the ones who came to plunder, to loot, to destroy our temples, to destroy our culture. Some of them went back after they looted India, some of them stayed on and got Indianized. But the other stream that came in is the Sufi stream, and that is not highlighted enough in this country. The Sufis came with a message of love and insaniyat, and hamahangi and brotherhood. Ghareeb Nawaz Maulana Chishti came over 1,000 years ago. He settled in Ajmer, and it became a light today. After Makkah and Medina itself, I think probably Ajmer is the greatest pilgrimage for Muslims around the world and for Indians. Bila lihaz mazhab o millat, regardless of their religion. You take Hazrat Nizamuddin here next door. What a great saint. And Khusro and Nizamuddin's extraordinary relationship. And lakhs of people go to Hazrat Nizamuddin from all religions. Because these Sufis, these saints, in Kashmir particularly, we have Chirar-e-Sharif, Alamdar-e-Kashmir, Sheikh Nuruddin Nurani, we have Maktoum Sahab, we have Baba Rishi, we have Hazrat Bal, we have all the great saints are there. And all the time we've been going there and praying. So you would pray at, there's a, Humayun's tomb is here, it's a very good place, beautifully done up. But nobody would dream of praying at Humayun's tomb. It is something you can watch and admire. But millions of people pray at Hazrat Nizamuddin. Because we have always in this country reserved our highest respect for men and women of spiritual striving and spiritual achievement. That is why whether it is the saints, whether it is the Sufis, whether it is great acharyas, whether it is great temple centers around the world, whether the kumbhas, where millions and millions of people gather, it's an astounding country. It's a country like no other in the world. And the Indian Muslims have played a very significant role and continue to play it. It is true that the country was partitioned in the name of religion, be that as it may, I think it was the, I'm not so much against the partition as at the way it was done. And the fact that millions of people lost their lives and their homes in the process. But in India today, our constitution gives us and our culture gives us freedom of religion. But we have to be very careful because there are forces at work which are trying to, as it were, radicalize the Muslim mind. And as Maulana Sahab said, these are the people who are causing this havoc around the world. Paris today, Bombay yesterday, New York day before yesterday, Brussels tomorrow. I mean, what is happening? How can in this day and age we continue to have these sort of things? And therefore, the two-pronged strategy, on the one hand, that whole idea must be defeated on the ground. I submit, and everybody need not agree with me, I submit that until there is a massive defeat on the ground, there will not be a real change among the masses. Among the intelligentsia, Maulana Sahib is quite right, all thinking Muslims around the world today must be asking themselves, ki ye hai Islam? Sari duniya mein badnaam ho gaye hum. Wherever Muslims used to live perfectly peacefully, unko shak ki nazar se dekha jata. They are all looked upon now with distrust. Because of the work of these people. So that rethinking, and also people like Maulana Sahab, who've spread the, I've read some of his books, and if you read his books, you find that the essence, as he puts it, of Islam is in fact not violence, it's the opposite. But there are elements, there are parts of the Hindu scriptures, not the Vedanta, but the Smritis and others, which are unacceptable. There may be parts of the Quran which today are not supposed to be highlighted. Therefore, we've got to get to the essence. We've got to find out what is it. For example, if you talk of the Vedanta, Ishavasyamidam sarvam yat kinchakityamjam. Everything that exists in the cosmos is permeated by the same divine force. Ishvara sarvabhutanam hriddeshe tishtati. The Lord resides in the heart of all beings. If you believe that the Lord resides in the heart of all beings, how can you then look with hatred or despise anybody regardless of what their religion or what their caste or what their creed? Bahujana sukhaya, bahujana hitaya. What better definition of socialism? The welfare of the many, the happiness of the many. So we have these concepts embedded in our culture. They need to be rearticulated. And we have to be very careful that we do not allow our citizens to be misled, and we do not allow hostile forces to impinge upon our diverse and multifaceted cultural heritage. So let me end by saying that there are two scenarios for the future of the human race. One is the scenario of Arthur Koestler, a European philosopher of the 20th century, who held that man is a creature programmed for self-destruction. He says there's an engineering defect in the human cortex whereby the thinking and the feeling elements are not adequately combined. And therefore, although we know what is right, we don't do it. As Duryodhana says, Janami dharmam nacha me privritti, Janami adharmam nacha me nivritti. I know what is right, but I am not attracted to it. I know what is wrong, but I am attracted to it. Kya karein iska? Kya ilaaj hai? So he says that ultimately the human race is bound to blow itself up because it is imperfect in its structure. The alternative scenario is Sri Aurobindo's scenario, who claims that the race is a human race is a race programmed for evolution. That in the same way as life has emerged from matter, from mineral to vegetable to animal to fish to the human race, there is no reason to believe that evolution will end with the human mind. The next step will be a leap from mind to supermind and man to super. So here are two scenarios. We do not want which we don't know yet which one is going to come true. You know, the jury is still out, as they say in America. And also, if the forces of peace are to prevail, there is such a thing as the time factor also. हमने माना कि तगाफुल न करोगे लेकिन खाक हो जाएंगे हम तुमको खबर होने तक by the time you decide what you're going to do we will have all been reduced to dust. Therefore there is a sense of urgency. We need a coalition. Like there's a coalition today of hatred, of violence, of negativism, of arms smuggling, of human trafficking, of all sorts of negative factors. We need a countervailing coalition of peace, of understanding, of creative reinterpretation of the great texts, of the interfaith movement. I look upon this meeting and Life Positive as part of the positive coalition that is being built. And on this occasion of the 20th anniversary, I wish you well. I'll end with a prayer. Prayer is for Mahalakshmi, not only for your bank balance, but Mahalakshmi, who is the goddess of all that is gracious and great and beautiful in human consciousness. May that great goddess bestow her blessings upon us all. Yasa Padmasanastha Vipulukatitati Padma Patrayatakshi Gambhira Vartana Bhistana Bharanvita Shubhravastuttariya Lakshmir Divyai Gajendrihi Manigana Khachitihi Napita Hemakumbhai Nityam Sa Padmahasta Tava Vasatu Grahe Sarva Mangalya Yukta.
Thank you.
Thank you so much, Dr. Karan, for your captivating address and also for your many blessings for Life Positive. Thank you so much. Your points were very interesting. They were, in fact, twofold. One was that the forces of evil need to be put down before transformation can actually happen. And the other was that the interfaith movement can be one positive way towards, let us say, putting to rest the forces of evil. So now I will throw open the dialogue to the audience. If you have any questions for either Maulana or Dr. Karan Singh, please raise your hand. Yeah, stand up here.
Ready? Maulana Ji, this question is addressed to you. Since you're doing so much good peace work towards this global cause, still, and I've met a lot of people like you working towards it, but still there is so much progress and a lot of terrorism and there are schools being promoted to teach to young kids, and that is so very sad. So is there any organization who's looking to stop that one thing at least? Because unless the root causes stop, the end will never stop.
Thank you. But I would say that you are talking about the past. I am talking about the future. Future, past was very dark. It is a fact. But now there is silver lining. You know, man can ignore everything, but cannot ignore his own interest. Previously, Muslim interest was not at stake. But now it is at stake after the rebar given by the would-be president of America. So, I see the future, and there is an example in Japan that is about nuclear attack that changed the Japanese mind. So is the case of Muslims. This remark is like a bomb, and it is bound to change the Muslim mind. It is my assessment.
I have a question.
Just a minute, he has already put
yes, it. Yes. Good afternoon. I am grateful to Sumaji and Mr. Karthikeyan for having invited me to your 20th anniversary of the Life Positive. I also read from time to time. My question is that we heard two very brilliant presentations, and we have the Sustainable Development Goals of the United Nations, which have been endorsed by all the countries of the world, and they have one goal, which is on peace and justice. So how can we leverage to get the interfaith dimension also included? I mean, they could not include it as a separate item, but then if unitedly, if we make this endeavor and we are committed to the interfaith movement, and we believe that if children are raised in that spirit of the interfaith education, then perhaps there will be less of prejudices, less of ignorance, and more commitment towards living in harmony. Like one of the UNESCO's 21st century goal for education is learning to live together. I have heard many expositions from Honorable Dr. Karan Singh, and he's on the UNESCO Executive Committee. But I want to know at the worldwide, how can collectively we can leverage to make this a ground reality?
So who are you addressing?
So I'm addressing, in fact, to both the honorable speakers, okay, and see how education can help us. And it also takes forward what the earlier questioner had also mentioned.
Right. Dr. Singh,
I'm A.K. Merchant. I'm with the Baha'i community. And we have this Lotus Temple in Delhi. Love to invite all of you.
You see, the Millennium Sustainable Goals, you remember, the Sustainable Development Goals, unfortunately do not specifically refer to the interfaith movement. I had tried in my own way to get it involved, but it is very difficult. It is highly political. So what we have to do now is to infuse the interfaith values into the various goals that we've adopted, and particularly into education. I think that education, what we've done is we have thrown the baby out along with the bathwater. We are not allowed to teach religion, I understand that, in a secular country. But that doesn't mean that we cannot teach the great ideals of all the great religions of the world. I have for many years been advocating that at least there should be one book which extracts positive, helpful, and creative ideas from the various religions of the world. It doesn't have to be a very big book, but let at least young people see and read. I mean, I have a quote from Ibn Arabi, an excellent quote. It's very much like, sounds like the Upanishads. From every religion you can get it. But that is not done. And that, I feel, is something I hope our new education policy that is coming up at least does that. The problem is, it's a very sensitive politically. So the moment you try and do something, you're immediately accused, you're trying to boost one religion or not. We have to take the view that a religion is not big or small because of the numbers. I mean, the Jews and the Parsis are small in number. That doesn't make their religion small. For them, their religion is as big, or the Baha'is for that matter. So we must get that involved somehow into our educational system, number one. Number two, we must step up the interfaith movement. The problem with the interfaith movement is that crores of rupees are spent on building temples and gurdwaras and churches and masjids and all. The interfaith movement is nobody's baby. So how do we finance the interfaith movement? How do we run it on a large scale, on a continuing scale? And thirdly, world leaders, I think, must realize the point Maulana Sahib made was very correct, that there has to be a rethinking, not only among the Muslims. There are also born-again Christians. There are other religions also have their fanatic fringes. There has to be a rethinking. It's going to be a process, but we must get involved. I am not satisfied with the level of involvement of the interfaith movement today in our public life. I feel that needs attention.
Wonderful. Maulanaji, would you like to add something to this?
I think what Dr. Kiran Singh has said is enough. I have nothing to add with this scholarly remark.
Wonderful. All right.
Thank you very much for this opportunity. It was a very captivating address. My question is to Dr. Kiran Singh. Sir, you mentioned that one of the important or the two-prong approach. One approach is to kill the ground forces, to the evil forces on ground. When I was listening to you, a question popped up in my head that, you know, something like this has happened before, let's say in the case of Al-Qaeda. Even if a terrorist or outfit like an ISIS is completely razed down this time, what will prevent the emergence of another terrorist outfit like that in future? And save the world from the terrorist menace that we have all been facing.
You know, there's always a possibility of re-emergence of negative factors. But after the destruction of Hitler and his forces, we have not had a resurgence of fascism in Europe. It can always happen after the defeat of the militaristic regime of Tojo's regime. In Japan, we have not had a recrudescence of militarism in Japan. So I agree with you that it is all, nothing is forever. It's a process. But my point is that the main organization that is propagating openly and violently, that has taken over vast swaths of land, until that is defeated, then it is difficult to really defeat others. But you are quite right, there are others. There are many growths. It's a hydra-headed monster. But nonetheless, I think we should start with the most powerful organization. That's fine.
All right. Anybody has any other questions?
Yes. Sorry, Maulana or Maulvi, you don't need to make this part of it. Shayad, you will make leadership there.
Following the bystander, although silently. It is very strange that no single alim of the world was able to say that I am with ISIS. Why? Because my ideas and my campaign is now acceptable for them, although silently. And without declaration, they are accepted by ideas. It is undeclared appreciation.
Beautiful, Maulanaji. Yes. May your tribe increase.
Yes. No, I want to make one thing clear. I'm not at all against peace. Peace is very, very important. In fact, all our prayers start with the Shanti part. There has to be peace. But, and I don't think we can say that talking about peace is wrong. We have to talk about peace while at the same time battling the forces of negativism. The two things have to go together. Because if we become purely a mirror image of those people, then we will lose our humanity. So the quest for peace will have to continue. And in fact, the reason why we want to battle these extremist forces is to re-establish peace. It's not at all to establish the superiority of one philosophy or another, to re-establish peace. And as Maulana Sahab said, after the Second World War, there's been world peace, but there have been dozens and dozens of wars, regional wars, state wars, civil wars and all. So this whole violence thing is something which has got to be dealt with separately. We could have a separate seminar on violence. What are the roots of violence? Are the roots of violence deep within human consciousness, or are they the result of outer circumstances? This is a very important discussion which can be carried on for a while. But I think the short point here is that while fighting the negative forces, we've got to continue to propagate peace. Every prayer, as you know, in India ends with Om Shanti, Shanti, Shanti. The peace that passeth all understanding. That is very important. Inner peace, as well as peace outside, because the two are reflections of each other.
Dr. Singh, I just wanted to ask one question in connection with this. I think both the sages of India and even Buddha very clearly said that, you know, the only way, you cannot fight evil with evil. You can only eliminate evil with goodness. So how do you respond
well,
to
you
that?
Well, you know, when, who was it who attacked Nalanda? Some sultan in Delhi. They attacked Nalanda. And 10,000 monks were killed in one day. And the library burnt for 6 months. I'm afraid love did not work very effectively there.
But that's hate.
Therefore,
work.
Well, hate doesn't work, but hate may not work. But one has to be able to withstand these attacks. One cannot say, okay, we love everybody, therefore hame maarte jao, hame maarte jao. That is not part of, I think, our tradition. Because ultimately, if you take the whole of the Durga Saptati, ultimately, when the evil forces had defeated everybody, then all the devas pooled their power. And interestingly, it was a feminine deity that emerged. It wasn't a masculine deity. No god emerged from that great experiment. It was Durga who emerged, so carrying in each one of her hands the weapon of all the various gods. And then she gave battle for 6 nights and 6 days. It's symbolic. And finally was able to vanquish it. So, you see, love is fine. And love should certainly be there. But then, I think also, I do not entirely agree with Gandhiji when he said that what the Jews should have done was to have accepted the fact that Hitler did. I don't think that is correct. I think that is not part of our tradition.
So is there a distinction you're making between self-defense and, what shall I say, an aggressive stance?
Self-defense is all right as a negative thing, but sometimes in order to ensure self-defense, you've got to go on the offensive.
But the question is domestic. Internationally, there is concern about radical Islam. Internally, domestically in India, since the BJP government, there is concern among the Muslim community and the Christian community that there is the fear. So Hinduism is supposed to be very tolerant, expansive. So what is actually happening on the ground? Are the apprehensions of Dr. Question is to you, Dr. Karan Singh. What is I know you are a Congress with Congress Party, but as a neutral person, what do you see the reality on the ground?
Well, let me say that apart party politics apart, it would certainly be unfortunate if the Vedantic principles of Hinduism, which I have tried to propagate around the world, are narrowed down within our own country. There have been some very unfortunate episodes which have really brought, as it were, our whole tradition into question. And there is, I come from a Muslim majority state myself, by the way. So I have lived among Muslims all my life. I worshipped at Muslim shrines. The first school I went to were Christian schools. I went to a Presentation Convent in Srinagar and Cathedral High School in Jammu, in Bombay. So I've been open to that. But yes, we have to be careful. I still feel that the really sort of elements, the so-called radical elements, are still fringe elements. But the Hindu intelligentsia also has to reassert itself. That's why I keep talking about it. In the same way as Maulana Saab says that the Muslims will have to rethink the philosophy of hatred and negativity if they follow it. I think Hindu intelligence here, you see, our approach towards Hinduism in this country has been very interesting. The intellectuals, by and large, the left-oriented intellectuals, have rejected Hinduism totally. And that is having a backlash now. Now that the so-called pro-Hindu parties in power, they want to make up for that. Now, both extremes are not correct. The rejection of our great Vedantic tradition by left-oriented intellectuals is something that is a very real thing. I remember it took me 30 years to have a center for Sanskrit studies opened in JNU, because Sanskrit was supposed to be, you know, a reactionary language, not a progressive language. Although the great progressive ideas are all found in Sanskrit. So there was that domination by a certain group, very brilliant people. I'm not criticizing them, but it was a definite leftward swing. And the left, as you know, the Communist Party, as you know, they were atheistic. I once asked Maulana Sahab, Mr. Khrushchev invited me, my wife and I went to Russia for 3 weeks, Soviet Union, and he gave a party for me in the Kremlin. And we were sitting around a table, and I asked Mr. General Secretary, is it possible in your country to be a believer and a member of the CPSU, Communist Party? He said, no. We respect religions, but to be a member of the CPSU, you have to be an atheist. So 3 generations of atheistic rule in Russia didn't crush the Christian spirit. When that regime collapsed, I was in Moscow again for the 1,000th anniversary of the advent of Christianity, and you should have seen the whole country exploded in joy. All the churches were redone and the icons came out. Why? Because religion is something very deep. Mongolia I went to. In Mongolia, the communists broke the temples, killed the monks, burnt the scriptures. As soon as the communist regime collapsed, the first thing they wanted was Buddhism back. And our ambassador was Kushuk Bakula. He became, as it were, the Padma Sambhava for Mongolia. I went there, I opened a school of Buddhist study. I'm not saying that we had a communist regime, but what I'm saying is the left-oriented intelligentsia tends to look upon religion as a necessary evil at best. Chalo ji, ye purani baatein hain, they'll go as soon as people develop. It is not happening. Some of the most articulate and some of the most the richest and well-off people now are becoming radicalized. So we have to, the intelligentsia has to rethink. And the Hindu intelligentsia also has to rethink. And they have to go back to the message of Vivekananda, to the message of Aurobindo, to the message of Ramana Maharishi, to the message of Tagore, to the message of the Vedanta. That, I think, is the important way. I agree with you, there are some causes to worry, but I think it is a good challenge for all of us.
Well, I think on